It's now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. We know this Liberal government can't get anything right with the neonics ban. The Liberals are telling farmers they can no longer use this pesticide. Yet, in the next breath, they're telling farmers that they must protect their crops for the corn flea beetle. Well, guess what, Mr. Speaker? The only possible treatment for this pest that has been approved in Canada is, you guessed it, neonics. Does the Premier agree with the principle that agriculture policy should be based on science, not emotion? And, Mr. Speaker, can the Premier name one single grain farmer in the province of Ontario that supports their reckless policy?
Do you see it, please? Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, on this side of the House, we believe that pollinator health is very, very important to the ecology of our planet, Mr. Speaker. And over the last 2 years, over winter honeybee mortality rates have exceeded what is normally expected. I understand, Mr. Speaker, that this is a huge concern. It's not just a concern among beekeepers, Mr. Speaker. This should be a concern for all of us, that we have strong pollinator health, Mr. Speaker, because really that is how the ecosystem works. So we've experienced in Ontario.
My intent is to remain consistent with my expectations from both sides. Questions put, answers put. I need to hear.
A large number of acute bee deaths, Mr. Speaker, spring, summer, and fall months. We're taking a precautionary approach, Mr. Speaker.
Immediately after I ask for attention, the minister from Prince Edward Hastings decides to challenge the member. I don't have a crystal ball. Member, come to order.
Precautionary approach, Mr. Speaker, and Ontario farmers who can demonstrate the need will continue to have access to neonicotinoid treated seeds, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary. Here on Bruce.
Of environment and climate change. Speaker, I know how much the minister is on Twitter, and I can tell you, if he cared to know what farmers think, he wouldn't be blocking some grain farmers from his personal account. The truth is, Speaker, I worry that the Liberals don't care what farmers think. Farmers continue to ask this government for clarification on how to protect their crops this season for the corn flea beetle, since the only treatment available is a seed treatment. But the minister won't say. In fact, Speaker, government officials have admitted to farmers that the minister has the power to fix this mistake and allow Ontario farmers to protect their crop this year against the corn flea beetle. So, Speaker, why won't the minister act? The minister has the power to work with farmers and prevent the loss of crops this season. So, Speaker, will the minister put politics aside today and actually work with grain farmers to develop this solution? Thank you very much.
The original question is directed to the Premier. It'll be directed to the Premier. It'll be the Premier's choice as to who answers the question. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I will just say to the leader and to the member opposite that this actually was an issue when I was the Minister of Agriculture, Mr. Speaker, Agriculture and Food, and we were working with beekeepers, Mr. Speaker. We were working with grain and oilseed farmers, Mr. Speaker, and the current minister.
The member from Leeds-Grenville. Carry on.
The current Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs and the Minister of Environment and Climate Change, Mr. Speaker, have worked very closely together because this is such an important issue. Of course, it's an important issue to grain farmers, but, Mr. Speaker, this is an important issue across the agriculture sector, and it's important, Mr. Speaker, across our society that we have strong pollinator health. Yep. Farmers who can demonstrate the need still can use neonicotinoid-treated seeds, Mr. Speaker, but the fact is, we have to make sure that we have strong bees in this province.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Back to the Premier. Premier, the facts speak for themselves. And, Speaker, the Liberals have botched the rollout of their neonics plan so badly they are now facing lawsuits from farmers. In fact, five busloads of grain farmers attended a hearing yesterday in Toronto to get the courts to clean up the Liberals' mess. Speaker, how many farmers will face financial hardship if changes aren't made to the ban? But you know what? Sadly, the Liberals refuse to listen. Speaker, does the Premier not understand the concerns of Ontario farmers? Or is it the Liberals' new agricultural policy to do what we say, or we'll see you in court?
Mr. Speaker, I would just say that you know, there has been an enormous amount of pressure from other jurisdictions in Europe and so on, Mr. Speaker, to actually put a ban in place on neonics. Mr. Speaker, we didn't do that.
We didn't do that.
We said, and I said, and the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs have said that putting a ban in place was not based in science. That wasn't what we were going to do.
The second time, the member asked the question, and heckling is not really, doesn't logic to me. No, it's not a debate. Carry on.
Didn't leap to that conclusion, Mr. Speaker. We've taken a precautionary approach, Mr. Speaker. Quebec has adopted and supports the same policy, Mr. Speaker. And as I have said, Ontario farmers who demonstrate the need, because there are different conditions in different parts of the province, who can demonstrate the need, can still use neonicotinoids, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. This is my last question in the legislature this week, and I wanted to remind everyone how much more expensive.
Tough talk. Yeah. Somebody might be looking for an early one. No, let's not use this to get the last shot in, please. Leader.
Mr. Speaker, I appreciate the government may be adverse to tough public policy questions, but I wanted to remind everyone during this last question how much more expensive life is in Ontario after this budget. According to the CBC report on February 26, this budget increases virtually every other government service fee. At the same time, it cuts popular middle-class tax credits like education and active children. Life is just more expensive for the average family. So, Mr. Speaker, my question is, how out of touch is our Premier?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm going to go over what our budget does, Mr. Speaker, and I hope that the leader of the opposition might see that there are some elements of this budget that he actually should support. So, for example, taking action on climate change and investing cap and trade proceeds transparently into green projects that reduce pollution, Mr. Speaker, that may be something he'd like to support, Mr. Speaker. Transforming student assistance, so actually providing free tuition for low-income families and more affordable. This is important, Mr. Speaker, because the Leader of the Opposition talked about the middle class. In fact, what our budget does is it provides more affordable tuition for middle-income families. So I would think he would support that. You know, Mr. Speaker, I was at the groundbreaking of a station on the Eglinton Crosstown today, Mr.
Absolutely. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Minister of Natural Resources said I was wrong when I called out the government for raising fees connected to his ministry. It appears the minister did not read page 190 and 191 of the budget. Those pages explicitly state fees will be going up. Page 190 specifically lists which fees are going up. Fees charged for driver and vehicle licensing, camping in Ontario parks, fishing and hunting licenses, just to name a few. Mr.
Speaker, Deputy House Leader.
I assume the Premier has a better grasp of what's in the budget than her ministers. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier apologize for making the lives of those in rural Ontario so much more expensive?
Thank you.
So, Mr. Speaker, let me just continue. I was talking about the infrastructure investment that we're making. I was at the groundbreaking of a station on the Eglinton line today, Mr. Speaker. And just to speak to the fee issue, Mr. Speaker, the lowering of hospital fees, the making shingles vaccine free for eligible seniors, Mr. Speaker, and the elimination of the dry clean emissions fee, Mr. Speaker. In addition to that, Mr. Speaker, helping families with the cost of electricity through the residential electricity user, saving them about $70 a year with the removal of the debt retirement charge, Mr. Speaker. And, Mr. Speaker, you know, the fact that we are improving services for children and youth with autism, a $333 million investment, Mr. Speaker, that will help hundreds of families around the province, middle income and otherwise, Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, that answer wasn't even remotely connected to the question. Not even remotely. You know, Mr. Speaker, if you have a child playing sports, the Liberals took that help away. Do you like the great outdoors? That costs you more now. Getting a degree, the Premier took those tax credits away. Have to renew your driver's license? Well, those fees are going up. Seniors needing medication? Sorry, the Liberals are making that more expensive. Mr. Speaker, can the Premier tell the South which one of her billion-dollar scandals that she's using all these fee increases to pay for? Is it e-health? Is it Orange? Is it the gas plants? Which one of this government scandals is this budget paying for?
Thank you.
I'm going to take a moment to ask the Deputy House Leader to kind of check his comments. Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I think that I would ask the Leader of the Opposition to talk to the 173,000 seniors, Mr. Speaker, who will no longer pay any deductible, Mr. Speaker. Because of the changes that we're making. I would ask the Leader of the Opposition to talk to the thousands of young people who are from low and middle-income families who are no longer going to have to pay tuition at all or not as much tuition, Mr. Speaker. They are going to have access to post-secondary education, Mr. Speaker, and therefore access to a better job that will help them in their lives but will also help our economy to grow, Mr. Speaker. I would ask the Leader of the Opposition to talk to those families. I would also ask the Leader of the Opposition to talk to the families of children with autism who have not been able to get service, Mr. Speaker, who are going to receive service, Mr. Speaker, and support and resources in order to get their children service. I'd ask him to talk to those families and see what they think about the support that they're getting, Mr. Speaker.
New question. The member from Nickelbelt.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The question is for the Premier.
And I can assure you that things cost more in Northern Ontario than they do down here. Seniors across Northern and rural Ontario also live with higher costs. Does the Premier think that it is fair to nearly double the drug cost for most seniors living in Northern and rural Ontario?
Mr. Speaker, I think that what is fair is that low-income seniors who are not able to pay the deductible for their medication, that we would remove that cost from them, Mr. Speaker, and that 173,000 more seniors would pay no deductible, Mr. Speaker, would receive their medications without any payment. I think that's what's fair, Mr. Speaker. In terms of the second part of that initiative, I have said over and over in this House that we have a regulation that has been posted. We are hearing from folks in the process of that consultation, Mr. Speaker, and if that threshold is not right, then we will, in response to what we hear, we will make a change. But 173,000 more seniors, Mr. Speaker, in the north, in rural communities, and in our urban and suburban centres will no longer have to pay a deductible, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, I and New Democrat believe that the strength of our health care system comes from universality. It is there for all of us. In public, the Premier certainly talks about universality of health care, but right now her actions are speaking louder than her words. Most seniors will see their medication costs get more expensive. Can the Premier tell us how many seniors will end up paying more for their medication?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I don't know if, I mean, I would have assumed, but I don't know if the member opposite understands that everyone who we're talking about in terms of the 173,000.
What I understand is the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek is coming closer to the Speaker, and I am hearing him again. Nor do I want to hear someone else armchair quarterbacking my rules. Please finish.
Those 173,000 seniors, Mr. Speaker, have been paying $100 deductible for their medications. They will no longer have to pay that, Mr. Speaker. So I actually would have thought that that would have been a policy that the NDP would support, removing a cost for seniors that has been there for many years, Mr. Speaker, and that they will no longer have to pay. Yeah. So we are removing that. 173,000 more seniors will not have to pay a deductible that they have been paying for many years, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I am worried about the 1 million seniors who will have to pay more. Most seniors in Northern Ontario can't afford to see their medication costs double. When the camera's on, the Premier is all about universal health care based on needs, not on ability to pay. We need more drug coverage. But you are moving. The Liberal government is moving in the complete opposite direction. It is a plan that is bad for 1 million Ontario seniors and doubly hard for the struggling seniors of the North. Does the Premier really think that another 20 days is needed to realize that her plans move Ontario in the wrong direction?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it is really disheartening to hear the third party talk about this program in this fashion when 173,000 new seniors will go from paying $100 deductible each year to paying $0 deductible. And I know the leader of the party is in the North today and tomorrow having consultations. I hope, I really hope, and I think it's her responsibility, not just to talk about the increase that was conceived of and considered in the budget that we're going to consult on, but to also talk about the 173,000 individuals who will no longer pay any annual deductible, because otherwise to do so is not doing the right thing for the people of Ontario.
That's right.
Many of those people reside in the North. They will benefit from this change. We're consulting on the rest of it, and it's a figure that's important, 173,000, so nearly half a million Ontario seniors will pay no deductible whatsoever.
Thank you. New question, the member from London Fanshawe.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, this morning I was joined by students, parents and advocates in calling on the government to ensure that specialized provincial and demonstration schools that support deaf, blind, deafblind and or other severely learning disabled students in Ontario will remain open. Provincial and demonstration schools play an important role in helping kids with exceptional needs to succeed. Parents, students, and community organizations are very concerned with the so-called consultations currently underway. If this government was truly consulting, they would not have stopped enrollment into these specialized schools. Speaker, my question is simple. Will the Premier guarantee that no provincial or demonstration school will be closed as a result of consultations? Yes or no?
Minister of Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you, Speaker. And I'd like to begin by welcoming to the legislature this morning students from the Robarts School for the Provincial School for the Deaf, and also, I believe, from the Amethyst School, Demonstration School in London. And I'm not sure if there are people from other locations, but I think Robarts and Amethyst families and students are here. So welcome to the legislature. And I do want to say, Speaker, that we're committed to the success and well-being of every child and student, including students who are deaf or hard of hearing, who are blind and have low vision, deaf-blind, or those with severe learning disabilities, just like the member opposite. We do care about that. I want to assure not just you, the Speaker, but also the families and students who are today that we have made no.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, I'd like to go back to the Premier. Speaker, kids who currently attend Amethyst Demonstration School in my community of London are here with us today. Students like Becca Haggett and Omar Elchami. Becca Haggett is also a pupil at the provincial-run Amethyst Demonstration School who has jumped 7 reading levels in less than 2 years. Omar has gone from a grade 2 reading level to a grade 7 reading level thanks to specialized programming and supports offered by Amethyst School. Speaker, we have heard from many other students across the province that these programs have the ability to truly change lives. In my community of London, both Amethyst and Robarts School for the Deaf are on the chopping block. Speaker, can the government please explain to these kids here today and across the province why they are stopping enrollment into such schools if they are really, truly only consulting?
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. And I've actually had the opportunity to visit with parents and visit with students, not just at Amethyst, but also at the Trillium Demonstration School in Milton and the Demonstration School at Centre-Jules-Léger in Ottawa, which is for the French language demonstration school. We're just sorting out the scheduling for Saganaska and Belleville. And I would like to agree with the member. It is very clear that the focused programming that is provided at the demonstration schools, the focus on reading, is absolutely transformingly effective for the students who talk about being able to enter the school with a kindergarten or grade 1 level and leave the program a year or two later at a grade 9 reading level. Speaker, that's totally transformational.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, I'd really like to hear from the Premier on this. The Minister of Education herself continually stands in the House and talks about how great provincial and demonstration schools are for our communities, the important role they play, the life-changing experience students are able to have. As such, it truly boggles the mind to think that this government is considering closing these programs, leaving our most vulnerable kids behind. I will ask again. Will the Premier admit her mistake and guarantee that all provincial and demonstration schools, including the ones in my community of London, will stay open?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister?
Yes, and what I want to reflect on, Speaker, is that the 4 demonstration schools serve about 155 children right now. We know that there are thousands of children in Ontario who are struggling to learn to read, and we want to make sure that we can learn from the programs in the demonstration schools. How do we deliver those focused programs that can help children catch up in their reading skills so that they can thrive in programs? And we need to figure out how to learn from the demonstration schools and to be able to do that all over the province, not just in 4 locations. We need to understand how we can help more children benefit from these wonderful programs which target children who are at average or above intelligence but who just haven't been able to learn.
Thank you. New question. The member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Thank you. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, today marks the third time in 3 weeks I've had to question the Premier and the Minister for their lack of oversight of what many are calling the rogue Liberal transit planning agency, Metrolinx. Mississauga Mayor Bonnie Crombie is calling Metrolinx's behaviour appalling, saying they operate within their own set of rules after inspecting yet another botched development for a simple bus station. Councillor Carolyn Parrish says she thinks it's appalling. This is disgusting, and she adds that she doesn't even trust them. Speaker, if our municipal colleagues don't trust them, how can the people of Ontario trust the Premier to oversee Metrolinx spending of billions for transit expansion across the province?
Very good question.
Minister of Transportation.
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I thank the member for his question. I actually had the chance to speak or converse last night or communicate last night with Mayor Bonnie Crombie from Mississauga. Had the chance to speak with a couple of our caucus members from Peel Region from Mississauga today, and also have spoken to Metrolinx Board Chair Rob Pritchard just this morning as well, Speaker. I understand that there are some concerns that have been expressed by residents in Mississauga as well as by municipal councillors. The commitment that I conveyed to the mayor was that we would continue to work with her and her council and her staff and her residents to make sure that we can get this right. Thanks very much, Speaker.
Thank you.
Busy night there. Speaker, in the last month, we've continued to hear stories of the Liberal Transit Planning Agency wasting taxpayers' money, from the UP Express planning to a train shed too small to fit the trains. And now we have a bus station in Mississauga where bathroom ventilation exhaust is aimed at
Minister
a swimming pool where bus passengers
time.
Appear over backyard fences into homes and lights that are shining all night. Mayor Crombie says there were design changes after the public consultation, leaving the neighbourhood to pay the price. Speaker, if Metrolinx is rogue, as the mayor indicates, then it's this government that has allowed it to go that way. It's their responsibility. Yes, it is. Speaker, will the Premier please explain to Ontarians how they can trust her with the billions of dollars she's overseeing to build, operate, and manage transit in Ontario?
Thanks very much, Speaker. As I mentioned in my original answer to the first question, I've had the chance to speak to the Mayor. We will, on a going-forward basis on this particular issue, continue to work with her, her council, people who live in her community, Speaker. But I have to point out, I have to point out that this is a government, thanks to the leadership of our Premier and our Mississauga MPPs on this side of the House, that is investing billions of dollars, including in Mississauga, the Cure Ontario LRT, Speaker, in addition to more GO service on the Lakeshore West Line and ultimately on the Milton Line that runs through Mississauga, Speaker. I know that Mayor Crombie and her council, and most importantly, the residents of Mississauga understand that, unlike the last time that party, the Conservatives were in power, we're building transit, we're not killing it, we're building, as the Premier mentioned, we were at an LRT station this morning, we're building along Eglinton, we're building in Mississauga. It's about time you recognize our progress.
Order. No question. Member.
My question is to the Minister of Finance. Last week, the Financial Accountability Office released its commentary on the budget's fiscal plan. The FAO says that this budget continues to rely on, and I quote, aggressive plans to limit the growth in program spending, end quote. The Liberal government likes to congratulate itself on the fact that Ontario already has the lowest program spending per person in the entire country. But New Democrats know that it's Ontarians who feel the impact day in and day out. The 2016 budget already doesn't keep up with inflation to meet the educational and the health care needs of Ontarians, building on years of cuts. My question to the minister is simple. This year's budget cuts almost $1.5 billion to the public service. What other program cuts are in store for Ontarians next year and the year after?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question. It gives me the opportunity to express once again
the tremendous amounts of investments that we're making in our economy, in our programs, in the programs that are essential and valuable to families across Ontario, like health care and education. Over $1 billion more is being invested in our education system, in our health care system. And, Mr. Speaker, we're being very progressive in this budget while still balancing the books by 2017-18 and thereafter. And this is done in consultation and with the work of many across Ontario. Our economy is growing, our businesses are growing, employment is growing, we have actually outpacing the United States in growth. Yeah. Our debt GDP is strong, Mr. Speaker, relative to what it was expected. And Mr. Speaker, we're heading forward and progressing forward because of the work we're doing in conjunction with the businesses and the people of Ontario.
Well, Speaker, the minister should read his own budget. On page 256, it's almost $1.5 billion in cuts to education and even post-secondary education in year cuts. The FAO, again to the minister, the FAO also highlighted that this government's fiscal plan depends on optimistic assumptions for revenue growth, pointing to more than $500 million year after year from asset sales, from more asset sales. The budget, however, isn't transparent. It doesn't tell Ontarians exactly what assets will be sold. And, Speaker, they can't blame us for questioning them. No one thought this government would sell off Hydro One. 80% of Ontarians have been loud and clear about stopping the sale of Hydro One, but this government refuses to listen to anyone, not even the citizens who took the time to come and speak to the Finance Committee directly through the budget process. Can the minister tell Ontarians exactly where that money is coming from, or is that a secret too?
So, Mr. Speaker, as Finance Minister, I did, in fact, invite the Finance Committee to meet to discuss some of the consultation, the work that was being done. They instead asked me to go to them, and I did. And I shared with them some of the work that had been going on and recognizing how important it is for us to continue investing. So let me clarify. We're investing more in health care. We're investing more in education. We're investing more in post-secondary. We're investing more in children and social services, like autism and special needs. Mr. Speaker, what we are doing is to provide more for cancer treatment, for hospitals, for home care, for long-term care, and for hospices and palliative care. The very things that was consulted in the consultations, Mr. Speaker, that's what people are asking for. That's what we're delivering. And, Mr. Speaker, we're balancing the books at the same time.
You see that, please? You see that, please?
New question? Member from Ottawa Orleans.
Merci, Monsieur.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of the Environment and Climate Change. Like everyone in this House and also within the PC party, I was genuinely surprised when the Leader of the Opposition proclaimed over the weekend that his party now supports carbon pricing. I was surprised given that the PC party of Ontario has bitterly resisted at every turn every single environmental initiative that our government has taken, from closing coal plants to investing in green energy, Mr. Speaker. And I also know that the minister has legislation before this House to combat climate change through a cap and trade. However, despite flip-flop by the Leader of the Opposition, I have continued to hear members of his own party oppose our plan.
Tell us who.
My question to the minister, can he inform the House on why the proposed plan to combat climate change is the best to reduce emissions while also growing our economy?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I think we recognize that to reduce emissions, people need help. So we have a fund coming from a polluter pay principle that puts money back. Many members over here are running online. We have carbon calculators and we have links to programs at the province and our municipalities. And it's interesting, Mr. Speaker, because the members opposite, Nipissing, Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, Halliburton, Kawartha Lakes, Brock, Lanark, Frontenac, Lennox and Addington, Perth Wellington, Sarnia Lambton and Haldeman Norfolk are all running online, online petitions against carbon taxes against their own party's position, Mr. Speaker.
focus.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. You know, and it was really wild for me because the member for Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke, Mr. Speaker, was demanding that we spend more money on home retrofits on propane and oil. At the same time, they're running petitions against any revenue, and the balance of the caucus thinks it should be revenue neutral, so there'll be no money for carbon reduction programs.
A reminder to stay focused on government policy, please.
Thank you to the minister for that response. It is indeed confusing where exactly the leader of the opposition stands and what the rest of actually his party believes.
I'm going to ask if members already have been instructed to stay on government policy, just ask the question in a different manner. Please.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I believe that our Premier said it best. It's better late than ever. So our government has taken significant action to fight climate change and are presenting a credible path forward with our cap and trade program. All proceeds from the cap and trade program must be reinvested in green projects that reduce or support the reduction of greenhouse gas. Can the ministers please inform all three parties on the strict rules and regulation that we have put forward about reinvesting our proceeds?
Thank you, Minister.
Thanks, Mr. Speaker. We, as I've said in the House before, we have some of the highest standards. We have an action plan. We can only spend this on GHG reductions. It's separately accounted for. It's reviewed. The greenhouse gas reduction account manages it. And we can only spend it on investments post-2014 that add net new greenhouse gas emissions. But we're very clear, Mr. Speaker, and I'm very proud to be part of a government that is providing global leadership right now on climate change. All of our members support our policy, Mr. Speaker. None of our members on this side, Mr. Speaker, are running rogue websites attacking our own party policies, and none of us believe that we believe it has to be revenue positive for people who are reducing their emissions. For the same reason that the member from Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke, Mr. Speaker, raised in the House. Every building has to be retrofitted. Every northerner has to have access to a low-carbon vehicle. Every farmer has to have offsets in their fields to get money and to put greenhouse gas emission reductions.
New question. Member from Oxford.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Speaker, over the last 2 years, I've asked the Minister about outrageous expenses at the Housing Services Corporation. He says the problem is solved because he hired Wyler & Company to do an independent review. But the review appears to be a long way from independent. Could the minister tell us whether Dennis Wyler, who made multiple donations to the Liberal Party, is the same Dennis Wyler of Wyler & Company that did the review?
I think so.
And is Dennis Waterston, who was a senior partner at Wyler & Company, is the same Daniel Waterston, who donated thousands to the Liberal Party and was Minister of Education CFO in two elections, and is married to someone who works in the minister's office?
Well, that's, Mr. Speaker, with all due respect, that's probably the strangest question I've ever received in the Legislative Assembly. I'll admit quite openly, I don't know any of the people that he mentioned. I don't know what their giving pattern is, and frankly, I don't care as long as they do what they do within the rules. That's their democratic right as an Ontario citizen. As for the Housing Services Corporation itself, the honourable members asked me, I think, on 35 different occasions for a substantive answer, and on all those occasions I have, so I don't have anything more to say.
Mr. Speaker, Wyler & Company did a review of expenses and didn't even notice the fact that people were using their corporate credit cards to pay for personal expenses, something that has cost many other people in government their jobs. They failed to find the problematic spending that we've raised right here in the legislature, and they didn't talk to a single housing provider. How can people have any confidence that the waste and mismanagement of the housing money that has been going on at Housing Services Corporation is solved, Minister? If the Liberal-friendly firm did the review, failed to find even the problems that we knew about already, is this just another Liberal cover-up?
The member will withdraw. And before I go to the minister, stop the clock. Before I go to the minister, I'm a little concerned of a pattern that seems to be being created, and that is, you know, you're going to be asked to withdraw, but you say it anyway. Get in front of it. Don't say it. It's not acceptable. Minister.
Speaker, I've spent a good portion of my time as Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing trying to put out the fires that the Honourable Member's Party started when they created the Housing Services Corporation. And you know, as you walk through, by the way, you had some good ideas when you set it up, and we want to hold on to those good ideas. The concept of the needs of everyone superseding the needs of the one, right? That's the principle that this was based on. It's a good principle. It was solid then, it's solid now. And we'll continue to walk through whatever little rubble is still there to pick up the pieces to make sure it works even better.
Thank you. New question, the member from Algoma, Manitoba.
Thank you, Speaker, and good morning to you. My question is to the Premier. Ontario steel communities are in crisis, Premier. We know this. These communities are seeing massive financial losses, job losses, mill closures, and foreign countries flood the markets. People in Sault Ste. Marie and Hamilton are being faced with layoffs and uncertainty. Workers and their families need an economic development plan that works for them. It seems as though the member from Sault Ste. Marie would rather deflect any demands to his federal counter-cousins in order to address the issue. Is the Premier and her minister prepared to come to Sault Ste. Marie and Hamilton to meet with municipal leaders, steel unions, and creditors, and work together to determine what measures this government, not the federal one, but this government, should be taken to assist these communities and put pressure on their federal government to impose tariffs?
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Of Economic Development, Employment, and Infrastructure.
Mr. Speaker, the issue that the member talks about is a very, very important issue. Take the NDP, Mr. Speaker, to take an important issue like the challenges facing our steel industry in Ontario and across North America and try to turn it into a partisan issue. Mr. Speaker, let me say this. There is not a member in this House that has gone to bat for the steel industry any harder than the member behind me, the member for Sault Ste. Marie. He talks about it every single day. He talks to me every day about this issue. He knows it's important to the suit. And, Mr. Speaker, he is working with us and our government to encourage the federal government to put in place the measures they need to be able to respond to these dumping challenges in a more effective way. I thank him for his leadership.
Answer. Thank you. Supplementary. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I was maybe in high school, but I remember an NDP government that rolled up their sleeves and got involved with Sault Ste. Marie when they needed help in the past. By the end of August, the money will run out, Mr. Speaker. Workers' pensions are not secured, and they have already had parts of their benefits cut. Steel communities are crying for help, have been falling on deaf ears of this government. We need action now. We need to work with all stakeholders to ensure steel communities are not completely devastated. Will the Premier and her minister stop grandstanding and deflecting to the feds and take action immediately for the people in the steel industry?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Order. Minister.
Speaker, the member obviously isn't aware, but there's a federal act in this country called the Special Import Measures Act. Mr. Speaker, that's the act under which parties can make applications to the federal government when there are dumping issues happening. There is no question, Mr. Speaker, there is dumping going on, whether it be from China, India, Russia, or other countries. That's severely hurting our steel industry here in Ontario and across North America. Mr. Speaker, the federal government is aware that there are challenges with the current act. The previous government was aware.
We'll try again.
The previous government was aware of this, planned to take action. We're too slow to do so. So we're counting on the new government in Ottawa, Mr. Speaker, to take the action
Answer.
They need to take to be able to respond effectively to these dumping issues.
Thank you. Any questions? The member from Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education. One of our top priorities is to support our children with the best possible start in life through our publicly funded education and early years systems, such as full-day kindergarten, which is of great benefit to my daughter and to tens of thousands of other young students. Our government has made significant gains in all four publicly funded education systems to provide a strong foundation for our students. And this year's budget will focus on getting Ontario on track to a balanced budget in 2017-2018. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, this year's 2016 budget includes key components for education. Can the minister share what things she's doing to continue to improve education for our children?
Great question.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, and thank you to the member for the question, and I'm so glad his daughter enjoyed FDK. And we believe that every child in Ontario deserves access to a world-class education and has the right to a supportive learning environment. So this year in the 2016 budget, we're addressing the recommendations from the put forward by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. We believe that all students, both Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal, are enriched by learning about the histories, cultures, and perspectives of First Nation, Métis, and Inuit people. As part of the 2016 budget, we're investing $15 million over 3 years, Speaker, to develop additional teaching resources, build capacity, and provide professional learning for our educators so that they can teach every student about residential schools, treaties, and the roles of Indigenous people in Canada.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, through you, I want to thank the minister for the answer. And we're very proud of the accomplishments and investments we've made in education. In my own riding of Etobicoke Lakeshore, I was pleased to find out of the funding to expand the Norseman Junior Middle School. And I'm also looking forward to hearing about the Grants for Student Needs, which is going to be released at the end of March. Mr. Speaker, this is going to better support students in the classroom. And I was also pleased to hear our government's commitment to ensure that school boards have the support required to successfully integrate Syrian newcomers into Ontario's education system and to make their transition as seamless as possible. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please share with us what is being done to support our Syrian newcomers?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you. And as part of our 2016 budget, we are also updating our enrollment forecast to expand the enrollment to allow for the expected children that will be coming from Syria. Approximately 4,000 Syrian newcomer children, we think. We're committed to ensuring that school boards have the resources required to support our Syrian newcomers as they enter our education system. We've begun by providing support for detailed initial assessments to determine what are our new students' needs. Some of them have come from very challenging situations. And then we're supporting language and mental health services to make sure that their transition to our education system is as seamless as possible. We continue to invest in the well-being of all our student speakers so that they can all become actively engaged and well-educated citizens.
Thank you. New question, the member from Nipissing.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. In a few minutes, we're going to be voting on the government's budget bill. It will make life in Ontario far more expensive and unaffordable. Tax credits that help children, families, and seniors are being eliminated. In fact, 92% of seniors will now pay almost double for their prescription drugs. The price of gasoline, home heating fuel, fees for drivers and vehicles, camping in provincial parks, fishing and hunting licenses, event permits, all going up, Speaker. But job forecasts are going down. Last year, the government projected 93,000 jobs would be created this year. Now, they're cutting their forecast by 15,000 jobs.
Order.
Speaker, does the Premier realize that all of the added costs in this budget
Question.
Will reduce disposable income, depress spending, and cut jobs?
Thank you.
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, we are going to be doing a vote on the budget bill, a budget that's the most progressive we've had in so many years, Mr. Speaker, that invests in our economy, an economy that is now outpacing and growing and leading Canada, an economy that's creating more jobs than ever before. We have a lower unemployment than the national average, Mr. Speaker. This is a budget that invests in infrastructure, a budget that invests and participates with business to maintain a very dynamic and competitive climate. A budget that invests in our people, in our young people. We're providing a tuition that's going to enable more people, more young people, to access post-secondary for free, Mr. Speaker. This is a budget that provides Social Security, retirement security.
A member from Hamilton East, Stoney Creek, can hide his voice, but I still hear it. Please.
Mr. Speaker, this is a budget that makes and enables Ontarians to be more competitive, and it's a long-term vision. The people opposite.
Thank you.
Supplementary.
Back to the Premier. The Liberals have made Ontario the most indebted subnational government on the planet. It took 137 years for this province to reach a debt of $139 billion when this government took office. But it only took them a dozen years, Speaker, to double that debt and now send it to $308 billion this year. That means we will be paying almost $1 billion every month just in interest. Their waste, mismanagement, and scandals are behind every decision they made. It was never what's good for the people, Speaker. It's always what's good for the Liberal Party. That's why they cut programs for children and seniors, why they doubled the price of drugs, and why they're raising the cost of everything, Speaker. Speaker, my question is, when is the Premier going to put the people
question.
Ahead of herself?
Mr. Speaker, as I was saying, the members opposite are not being progressive at all. What they are showing right now by their very actions is short-term thinking,
exactly.
And they want us to go back in time when, Mr. Speaker, we had worse conditions and less competitiveness. Mr. Speaker, our net debt to GDP ratio, which is an important measure of our ability to service debt, is actually lower than anticipated.
The member from Lanark, come to order.
Mr. Speaker, our accumulated deficit to GDP is the same today as it was 12 years ago. And, Mr. Speaker, our interest on debt, which the member opposite just made reference to, our interest on debt today is that it's just about 8.9%. When they were in power, it was 15%. It was much higher than it is today. We are managing our debt. We are investing. We're investing in infrastructure. We're investing in our communities to make us more competitive, and our economy is growing.
Thank you. New question. Member from Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker. And my question is to the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services. Speaker, as we know, in October, 31 dogs were rescued from a horrible dogfighting ring in Tilbury, where they had been subjected to years of cruel and barbaric treatment. Since their rescue, the OSPCA has filed a court application to have 21 of these dogs euthanized, even though organizations have been lining up with offers to rehabilitate them in or outside the province. Speaker, these dogs have suffered at the hands of humans, yet this government feels the only humane decision is to put them to death. You can stop this. All dogs deserve to be protected. Will the government grant a special designation and commit to protecting these dogs instead of condemning them to die?
Thank you. Minister of Community Safety and Correction.
Well, Speaker, I will remind the member again, as I did yesterday, that she's asking about a court process which is underway right now involving the OSPCA. Speaker, we do understand that this is a challenging issue and many individuals and organizations are concerned across the province. But as the member knows, Speaker, there is currently an application to the court by the OSPCA for permission to euthanize 21 of the 31 pit bull dogs seized from an alleged dog fighting operation, citing risks to public safety. However, Speaker, the remaining dogs are being rehabilitated for relocation outside the process. OSPCA, as Speaker, you are well aware, and the members are aware, is the organization that is responsible for animal welfare. They have significant expertise in matters relating to animals and their welfare and rehabilitation. They're pursuing a court process. We should respect that process, Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. These dogs can be rehabilitated. There are experienced and caring organizations lining up for the opportunity, loving homes to adopt them. Your instinct is that killing these dogs is a better option. At no point should killing these dogs even be an option. We've had this conversation before. This is the same government that nearly allowed 99 animals to be put down after a ringworm outbreak. Minister, this is the wrong decision again. As long as this government continues to support breed-specific legislation, these dogs will always be at risk. Will the government do the right thing, work with organizations that actually want to rescue these animals, or is putting them to death your final answer?
Thank you.
Speaker, our government takes the care and protection of animals in Ontario very, very seriously. We are proud, Speaker, to have some of the highest standards for animal welfare in Canada. The OSPCA, Speaker, is an independent charitable organization that provides a number of services such as animal shelters, veterinary and spay neuter clinics, and public education about animal welfare. Additionally, Speaker, the OSPCA Act, which is a legislation of this House, authorizes SPCA inspectors and agents to enforce any law pertaining to the welfare of animals. Police, Speaker, may also enforce those laws. Contrary to the public report, Speaker, I want to repeat this again. The Government of Ontario does not currently have legislative authority or regulatory authority to direct the OSPCA to take or not to take any particular action. This matters before the courts. A judge will make a determination. OSPCA is seeking that approval. We should let the court proceed based on the law.
Thank you. New question, the member from Northumberland, Quinty West.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Energy. Minister, as a proud representative of Northumberland Quinty West, I know very well that we are blessed with many advantages living in beautiful rural Ontario. However, there is also some additional challenges. In rural areas, residents face fewer options when it comes to their energy supply and costs, specifically heating our homes. Many rural areas do not have access to natural gas and must use alternative methods to heat during cold periods. Many rural residents ask for better alternative options to heat for heating, including existing access to natural gas for rural communities. Mr. Speaker, I know this government is listening to rural Ontarians and building a plan to help make life easier. Through you to the minister, what action is being taken to benefit rural Ontarians and their energy needs?
Minister of Energy.
Speaker, I thank the member from Northumberland, Quinty West, for the question. Our government is taking major steps towards providing less expensive home heating for rural communities. Last year, I wrote to the Ontario Energy Board asking them to explore opportunities to facilitate access to natural gas, and now the OEB is holding public hearings on how best to recover the costs associated with providing gas to communities that currently do not have access. In fact, Speaker, Union Gas has already applied for approval to extend natural gas into 5 rural communities, and they are working with a large number of others, Speaker. Also, as mentioned in the 2016 budget, which we're voting on today, Speaker, our government is developing a $200 million natural gas access loan program and $30 million natural gas economic development grant to help communities accelerate their access to natural gas. Speaker, we're listening to the rural communities.
Thank you, Minister. This government is committed to extending access to natural gas in rural communities is incredibly important to our rural energy customers. However, This government is very aware of the current pressure living in rural communities and have a number that have a number of programs to assist rural customers with cost of electricity, including rural and remote electricity rate protection program. When you look at the proposal in the 2016 budget, the priority is to build a smarter, more sustainable and efficient energy system is very clear. Last month, this government used investments in measures that will help rural Ontarians save money on their energy bill if they heat through natural gas, oil or propane. The efficiency savings that can come from new technologies and surprising. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, what initiatives are designed to help rural customers afford their daily energy costs?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, last month we announced an additional investment of $100 million to the Green Investment Fund to help homeowners reduce their energy bills and cut greenhouse gas emissions. We're working with Enbridge and Union Gas to offer the program outside of their service territories and to homeowners who heat their homes with natural gas, oil and propane. This will help about 37,000 more homeowners conduct audits to identify energy-saving opportunities and then take actions, such as replacing furnaces or water heaters and upgrading insulation. Secondly, Speaker, Hydro One has launched a heat pump pilot program to help customers with electric space heating and water heating. If you heat your home by electricity, Hydro One will pay 50% of the cost for an industry-leading air source heat pump, reducing space heating costs by 50% with savings of $750 to $1,500 per year, Mr. Speaker. Wow. Hydro One will also pay up to $800 for a water heating air source heat pump, reducing water heating costs by
50%. Thank you. Any questions? The member from Stormont, Dundas, South Glengarry.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Minister of Energy. Minister, the Independent Electricity Systems Operator just approved a massive wind project in North Stormont. An unwilling host township where the population came together to oppose the wind farm. You just said a few minutes ago that you're listening to rural communities. So why do you allow your agencies to ignore the municipal decisions?
Thank you, Minister of Energy.
The successes today, Mr. Speaker, with respect to these announcements, is that five wind contracts with an average price of 8.59 cents per kilowatt hour, significantly less than the average price of 2009, Mr. Speaker, for a large feed-in tariff. Seven solar contracts with an average price of 15.67 cents per kilowatt hour, 28 cents less, Mr. Speaker.
You can look directly at me and start the heckling. You should have stopped. So the member from Leeds Grenville, second time. Carry on.
Next, Mr. Speaker, 28 cents less per kilowatt hour. But most importantly, Mr. Speaker, in addition to these successes of lower prices, there are great achievements and support for these projects. More than 80% of the projects include participation from one or more Aboriginal communities. Five projects with 50%, Mr. Speaker. More than 75% of the successful proposals receive support from local municipalities, and more than 60% have support from neighboring
municipalities. Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the minister. Minister, the community took you at your word. They turned down $650,000 a year, a bribe by the company if they would become a willing host, and the community turned it down. Now they have the project and they don't have the money. How do you explain that to them? Somebody that trusted this government and somebody else that just got burned. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, that there were negotiations between the municipality and the proponent. Mr. Speaker, Ontario is securing a future in clean, reliable, and affordable electricity. We already benefit from 90% emissions-free electricity generated by a diverse supply of generation sources, including wind, solar, nuclear, hydroelectricity, and bioenergy. Today's results in these contracts, Mr. Speaker, confirm wind and solar power are now on a level playing field with other forms of generation. By putting emphasis on price and the support of host communities, today's results put further downward pressure on the electricity price projections in Ontario's long-term energy plan. Speaker, today builds on our success over the past 10 years in moving forward to a greener energy system.
Thank you. Bravo. Before we move to the deferred votes, I have an announcement. This is the last day for our pages. And I want to say to them on your behalf, thank you for a job well done. We appreciate it very much. Thank you. We have a deferred vote on the motion for second reading of Bill 173, an act to implement budget measures and to enact or amend various statutes. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bill. Would all members please take their seats? All members, take your seats, please. On February 29, 2016, Mr. Souza moved second reading of Bill 173. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. You're recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr.
Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayeur.
Madame Mayeur.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time to be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Cove.
Mr. Cove.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantal.
Mr. Vantal.
Ms. DeNova.
Ms. DeNova.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelinas.
Madame Jelinas.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 53, the nays are 33.
The ayes being 53 and the nays being 33, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture du projet de loi.
Pursuant to the order of the House dated March 9, 2016, the bill is ordered referred to the Standing Committee on Finance and Economic Affairs. We have a deferred vote on the motion for closure for the motion of second reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. On March 1, 2016, Mr. Gravel moved second reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. Mr. Fraser has moved that the question be now put. All those in favour of Mr. Fraser's motion, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Forster.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 52, the nays are 33.
The ayes being 52 and the nays being 33, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Gravel has moved second. Sorry, Mr. Gravel has moved second reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gases. All those in favour of the motion, please rise one at a time. Sorry. I missed a spot. Is it the pleasure of the House? Is it the pleasure of the House that the motion carry?
No.
I heard a no. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say nay.
Nay.
In my opinion, the ayes have it. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bill. Thank you. Mr. Gravel has moved second reading of Bill 172, an act respecting greenhouse gas. All those in favour, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms.
Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker. Speaker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantaw.
Mr. Vantaw.
Ms. DeNova.
Ms. DeNova.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. Come on, get
up. Oh. All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Miller, Parisan, Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Parisan, Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Ms. Martell.
Ms. Martell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettifees.
Mr. Pettifees.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole. The ayes are 66, the nays are 19.
The ayes being 66 and the nays being 19, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture du projet de loi.
Shall the bill be ordered for third reading?
General government, please.
Change. General government. So ordered. Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member for Stormont Dundas South Glengarry. Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member from Stormont Dundas South Glengarry has given notice of his dissatisfaction with the answer of this question given by the Minister of Energy concerning North Stormont Wind Farm. The matter will be debated Tuesday, March the 22nd at 6 p.m. There are no further deferred votes. I offer my best wishes to all members. To enjoy themselves, get a chance to be with their families, and also do the constituency work that they always do. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.